Quý thầy cô, các anh, các chị và các bạn, bây giờ chúng ta sang cái phần phiên chính thức của buổi chiều nay về vấn đề bệnh phổi tắc nghẽn mãn tính. Thì trước hết tôi xin trân trọng giới thiệu với tất cả quý vị giáo sư tiến sĩ Mina Gaga. Giáo sư tiến sĩ Mina Gaga là chủ tịch Hội Hốp Châu, đồng thời cô là phụ trách chuyên môn của Bệnh viện Lồng ngực Athens. Thì giáo sư đã có tham gia rất nhiều trong cái công tác cả về lâm sàng điều trị bệnh nhân hen cũng như về các nghiên cứu về hen, về ung thư, và tham gia cái chương trình tham gia cái đào tạo cho các cái bác sĩ về y khoa cả về hen COPD và trong đặc biệt là những về vấn đề hen nặng. Chiều nay thì giáo sư Mina Gaga sẽ trình bày với chúng ta về điều trị về cấp bệnh phổi tắc nghẽn mãn tính. Xin trân trọng giới thiệu và kính mời giáo sư tiến sĩ Mina Gaga. Please.
Hello, thank you for the introduction. I think the slides are still loading. So I'll
các bạn xem bật the slide chưa? So please wait one.
Okay. So thank you very much. We're ready. Okay. Yes. So I'm going to talk about treatment of COPD exacerbations and a little about COPD in general. Yes. And I'm just starting with this study, which was published by two very important people in COPD, Alvaro Agustí and Bartolomeo Celli, discussing what are the unanswered questions in COPD. And of course, there are too many. Whether it is a single disease or whether it is a systematic disease, what are the causes of exacerbations? Very, very many unanswered questions that we really need to talk about. And how COPD is and how many exacerbations you get and which are the type of patients you see very much is a factor of the setting in which you practice medicine. For example, in red here, you can see people with COPD treated in the community. And you can see that the majority are either A, almost 80%, and B, and very few are C and D. But if you work in a hospital, then this is reversed, and the majority of your patients are C and D. Regardless of whether they're advanced COPD or early COPD, all patients get exacerbations. And in fact, many of our patients with COPD will go to the primary care physician with a cold, and they will come again with a cold, and they will come again with a cold, and they are diagnosed with colds for about 3 years before anyone decides to check whether these people have COPD. So you can see here, and I'm not sure, this is the, you can see here whether it's mild COPD, moderate COPD, or severe COPD, patients do get hospitalizations. They get oral corticosteroids, antibiotics, or both. And any exacerbations are present in all three stages of COPD. And even under specialist care, the thing seems to be the same. They get exacerbations in quite a large number of patients get exacerbations. So we need to understand what causes the exacerbations and what should we treat? Sorry? Sorry? It's not working? Right now it's not. Thank you. Okay. So to treat the patient, we need to understand how severe the exacerbation is, also to know how severe the disease is, to understand the type of inflammation, whether it is linked to an infection or whether it is an inflammatory disease. And we also need to understand whether there are complications and multimorbidity for the patient, because this plays also a very important role. And I think there should have been another. Sorry, I'm just moving. Here we are. Okay, this is the study was presented also this morning. It is from Mona Bafadel, working with Ian Pavort at the time, who described four types of COPD exacerbation. One is linked to bacterial infection. One is linked to inflammatory eosinophilic disease. One is linked to viral disease, and one is postgranular. That we see no, we understand not why the patient has had an exacerbation. And as I said earlier, it is very important to see whether the patients have multimorbidity, because as you can see here, the majority of our patients with COPD have multimorbidity. They may have diabetes, they may have coronary artery disease, they may have hypertension, thyroid disease. Whatever they have, it interferes with their COPD, and it also interferes with the treatment of COPD. So this is really something we need to take into account. And I'll start with a case, with a patient. This is a patient who's 67 years old. He's had 50 years of history of COPD, and he's diagnosed with COPD. He has an FEV1 baseline of 58%. So you can say this is a moderate COPD with a ratio of under 60. He has had no exacerbations that he knows of in the past year. He's on dual treatment with LAMA-LABA, and he presents to you with breathlessness, white sputum, more than he usually has. He has a respiratory rate of 20 and an SO2 of 92. So what do you do with this patient? Is there evidence of infection? Is it a severe exacerbation? Should we hospitalize? Should we prescribe steroids? Thank you. Okay, first of all, is it severe disease? What we should know to treat the exacerbation? Is there a systemic inflammation? Does the patient have eosinophilia? Is there an infection? Does the patient have purulent sputum or evidence of infection, high PCR, for example, and other comorbidities? And let's see what the patients. How can we help this using biomarkers? Well, actually, a very large number of biomarkers have been tested in COPD, and maybe we will have molecular signatures in the future, but at the moment, no marker has been shown to work better than the clinical markers described by Antonissen 30 years ago. So if the patient has purulent sputum, more sputum than usual, high fever, then this is a marker of infection. We can also check CRP, of course. We can do spirometry. We can check oxygen saturation, which can be checked everywhere in a private practice or in a community setting. And of course, we can then, at a hospital setting, examine blood gases and things, and decide whether this is inflammation, and decide about the severity of COPD. This is a very, you can't read it, but it's a good paper, and you should probably, if you haven't seen it, refer to it. It was published in the New England Journal of Medicine some years ago, and it tells us how we can treat patients with antibiotics. And what they tell us is we should only use antibiotics if there's a very strong evidence of infection clinically, or if it's a very severe exacerbation. And then the patient is bound to get an overinfection if he doesn't get one from the beginning. And this is New England Journal of Medicine some 10 years ago. It's a very good article. So this is when the clinical practice says we use antibiotics. What about steroids? This is again an old study from Chris Breitling from Leicester, showing how the patients respond to steroids according to their eosinophil in the peripheral blood. And as you can see, those who have very few eosinophils do not respond to steroids. Those who are in the middle, respond somewhat. And those who have high eosinophilia respond very well to steroids as expected. So again, steroids should be used in those patients who have eosinophilia or those who have very severe disease. So when do we prescribe systemic steroids? For those patients with an eosinophilic phenotype, for those patients with very severe airflow limitation, and again, we need some more evidence, but this is what the practice has shown that works, and very severe patients that need hospitalizations. And those with recurring exacerbations as well. These are the phenotypes of patients who seem to respond better to oral steroids. What is also true recently is that shorter duration of steroids works equally well and has fewer exacerbations. And it has the same readmission rate. So whether we prescribe steroids for 5 or up to 7 days works equally well as when prescribing oral steroids for 15 days or more. So we should try and cut down steroids as early as possible. And this study was also presented this morning. It comes from Diana Stoltz. It was published last year. They randomized patients to receive high doses of inhaled steroids plus short-acting beta agonist at the beginning of an exacerbation, and they demonstrated that this works, that patients who receive this high dose inhaled treatment do better with the exacerbation. So this is something that can be used in exacerbation of COPD. And regarding comorbidities, of course, when patients have arrhythmias, for example, you have to use LABAs or SABAs with caution. There's an increased myocardial infarction rate because of the hypoxemia, so we have to be extremely careful with the patients. Medications that we use for COPD can cause side effects. Steroids may completely dysregulate diabetes, for example. So we have to treat our patients in a holistic and personalized way. There are no guidelines to fit every patient we have. So going back to this patient described earlier, this patient has a moderate COPD, so it's not severe disease. His saturation is still quite good at 92, so it's not a severe exacerbation. There's no evidence of infection. He has no purulent sputum. He has no fever, so no need for steroids. So we can just increase his inhaled steroids, and if he doesn't do well, then we can see him again in a couple of days. But for the time being, he doesn't need any specific high-grade treatment. And we can look at another case. This is an older woman. She's 82 years old. She has a shorter history of smoking of 40-pack years, but still quite an important history of smoking. She's a diagnosed COPD patient. She has a far lower FEV1 than the previous patient. So it's severe COPD with a severely defected ratio of FEV1, FVC ratio. She's had a history of 2 exacerbations in the previous year, and she's on triple treatment already. She has coronary arterial disease with a stent. She has hypertension. She is receiving treatment with aspirin, clopidogrel, and ramipril. She has thyroid dysfunction and has replacement with T4, and type 2 diabetes on metformin. She comes to you with severe breathlessness, with cough, with a lot of sputum, and it's yellow sputum, and her SO2 is 87%. So would you consider this a severe exacerbation? This is severe COPD. By definition, it's severe COPD. So we need to hospitalize it. And it's complicated because the patient has coronary arterial disease, diabetes, 3 or 4 comorbidities. She needs steroids because it is severe disease, but steroids will dysregulate her diabetes. So although she's treated with metformin, she will need probably insulin treatment while she's hospitalized and receiving steroids. There is evidence of infection with a yellow sputum, so she will need antibiotic treatment, and she is hypoxemic, so she will need oxygen supplementation. Then, if once she's hospitalized, she has hypercapnia, she may require non-invasive ventilation as well. And then if she doesn't respond, she may even require invasive ventilation. This is something we can describe. This patient has no history of hospitalizations or previous intubations, so she would be a candidate in most areas of the world for intubation as well. So to sort of work on this COPD treatment, it has to be personalized. We need to prescribe inhaled medication, increase the inhaled medication, inhale steroids and antibiotics only after personalizing and making sure that the patient needs them, oxygen supplementation if the patient needs it, non-invasive ventilation if it's severe exacerbation, and we have to be aware of the other medications that the patient is receiving and also of the side effects of the medications. And we also have, of course, to be careful of electrolyte imbalance, replace, or add fluid. We have also, after the exacerbation, to prevent future exacerbations, because as you know, after an exacerbation, the mortality goes high for the patients, increases. And we also need to prevent disease progression, because this is also linked to exacerbation. So to do that, first of all, we need to diagnose early COPD, advise the patient to stop smoking, for example, and enter the patients into smoking cessation programs if they're still smoking, but also prescribe treatment early on. And who do we need to test? Of course, the smokers, people who come with frequent colds and may have COPD, people who have respiratory symptoms. This is, I'm just showing you the guidelines as presented in the ERS of the management of COPD exacerbations. And again, I don't want you to read them. What I want you to see is that every recommendation is weak, because the evidence is simply not there. So we have thousands, millions of patients with COPD. We have quite a number of studies, but most of the studies are done for a specific reason, and we lack a lot of evidence that is needed to really manage COPD patients as we have to. And other things that help, of course, is the holistic approach, and also not just pharmacotherapy, but also the lifestyle of the patient. So we should advise our patients, of course, to quit smoking, to eat healthily, to keep their weight at a healthy rate, to take exercise. And it has been shown that people who work on personalized management plans and who have community support and go on to exercise training get a lot better than patients who don't. And this is from two studies showing that patients who have rehabilitation programs, and rehabilitation programs have to do with everything, with the lifestyle, with the exercise, with food, with the way people face their lives, they tend to get far less readmissions, they tend to get far fewer exacerbations in the future. It's not just treatment and pharmacotherapy, it is also the level of education that the patient has, and this we have to be aware, and this is something that we can only work with our public health and local ministries. This is a study from Belgium, and I think it's very important. It shows in Belgium, which is a country that has a very high standard of living and a good health system, that patients who have basic education, so elementary school, at 20 years of age, have another 28 years of healthy living in front of them. Patients with intermediate education have more, and patients with university education at the age of 20 have 46 years almost of healthy lives living in front of them. And that means that if you have education, you can have a better lifestyle, prevent COPD, prevent other diseases, and be healthier. And that is why we have to work with our local policymakers and make sure that our patients do get this. And of course, prevention is better than treatment, and smoking is very important. Self-management and support is also very important. And building patient groups and also healthcare people groups is very important. And this is what we want for our patients. We can't have them all as Olympic athletes, but we certainly don't want them in bed and under oxygen 24 hours a day. About pharmacological treatment to prevent exacerbations, there are studies showing that the combination of inhaled steroids, LABA, are better than the combination of LAMA and LABA, and this is from the sulfur study. You probably know it. All the studies so far are led by the industry, and each industry is trying to prove that their own combination or their own medication is very good. And all the medications are indeed very good, and the studies are important, but they are done for a specific reason. So this is the sulfur study showing that ICS LABA is better than usual care. This is the crystal study showing that LAMA-LABA is better than ICS-LABA. And this is a meta-analysis showing the same thing. It is sort of led by pharma. And this is the impact study, which was published just a few months ago, showing that triple treatment is better for our COPD patients. But again, we need to find which patient is the best candidate for which treatment, and then prescribe treatment. We should not prescribe triple treatment for all our patients. And we should also take into consideration that patients have their own preferences also for the inhaler device. This is from a study we did some time ago. In asthma, it didn't seem that much of a difference, but in COPD, patients seem to favor specific devices. Again, the device is something we should work with the patient, discuss with the patient, and make sure that it works for the patient. And this is where the ERS, and now with the joint membership, you as well, can help join our effort and do pragmatic trials like the Salford study, but not led by the industry, led by ourselves and trying to find the answers. For example, there's this Preductimab trial in Belgium where the doctors are trying to understand whether in a patient who has both allergy and eosinophilia, it is better to prescribe omalizumab or mepolizumab. This is one study. We will have the results in a short time, and it is investigator-led. And I showed earlier, in the ERS, we have eight main disease areas. The first one is airways disease. There are already a lot of clinical research collaborations. Sharp is severe asthma. There's a NeuroCAF. So it is important, if we all join forces and we can deal with the problems we actually have in clinical practice, how to deal with a specific patient, who is the best candidate for which treatment, and we gather data from all around the world using our own data in specific platforms, and getting those data, we can certainly manage to treat our patients better and lead, for all of us, a more evidence-based, better care for our patients. And this is what I had to say. Thank you very much for your attention.